just 1 minute while you are coming and having a seat, I just introduced the seminar series, which is the colloquia of the math department. And it just started, you know, it's the second appointment. It's a big honor for us to have a distinguished guest that will be introduced by Christiana Bertolin. I just want to mention that this series is of the whole department of mathematics and computer science, so colleagues are welcome to contact me and other people in the committee to give suggestions or for other reason. And I mentioned I also want to thank a lot people who makes possible to stream it as it was requested by other colleagues, also our colleagues that now are traveling and are not here. And this is possible. Thank you very much for your help. And I also want to help to thank the administration for the big work that is doing also for this occasion. I leave to the introduction of our guest.
Okay, thank you. So it's a great honor for me to introduce Professor Laurent Lafogue. He was student of the École Normale Supérieure. Then in 1994, he got his PhD at the University of Orsay under the supervision of Professor Gérard Lemont. Then from 2000 until 2021, he was a permanent professor of the IHES. And from 2021, he is researcher at the Huawei Paris Centre de Recherche. He got a lot of international prizes. The most relevant is the prize Prix Écho-Picot du Collège de France. Then he was a Médaille du Bronze du CNRS. Then he get the Clay Research Award and Mongordo, the Fields Medal in 2002. So now I think we can start the talk. I thank Professor Laurent Lafogue again, and we can start.
Okay, so thank you. So thank you very much for inviting me. For a French mathematician as I am, it is always especially nice to be invited in Italy. In fact, it is my first day here in Padova, so I am all the more happy to discover the city and the university. Okay, so thank you very much for inviting me. And I am also very happy that I can see many young faces, I suppose students, PhD students, postdocs. So the subject I am going to talk about, I think, is new for many people. So this means that anybody who wants to get interested into the subject has to learn. And of course, it is easier to learn for young people. So my talk will not be technical. I just want to introduce you to some basic loose ideas about this subject I am going to talk about, Grothendieck topoises. And of course, it may give some of you incentive to begin learning the subject. Okay, so I am going to talk about Grothendieck topoises in the perspective of AI, because, in fact, the connection with AI appeared a few years ago, somehow by chance, and by now, for some people I know and for myself, it has become very important. Okay, so the notion of topos was introduced by Grothendieck, whom many consider as the greatest mathematician of the 20th century. So it was introduced around 1960, and it depends on two key notions. Certainly, some of the most important new notions which were introduced in mathematics in the 20th century. And these two notions, in fact, had been introduced during the Second World War. The first of these notions is the notion of chiffre, which was introduced by a French mathematician, so Jean Leray. In fact, he was a prisoner of war, and he had nothing to do. So he invented chiffres. And this notion brought a revolution, at least in some parts of mathematics. So I will not define the notion of chiffre. In fact, I am sure that so at least part of you already know this notion. I just make a few remarks. So the first, the fact that in the original definition of Leray, chiffres were linear chiffres. So they had some linear structure. Secondly, they were defined in the context of topological spaces. Of course, the notion of topological space had already been defined a few decades before. And the last remark is that the initial definition by Leray is not exactly the definition which has become used usual for mathematicians today. In fact, the present definition was a slight modification of the initial definition, and it was made by Henri Cartan. The second notion, which was introduced at the same moment by Eilenberg and MacLean, is a notion of category. And it comes together with two other notions, the notion of functors and the notion of natural transformation of functors. So this is a very abstract mathematics. When these notions were introduced, they were not considered very serious by most people, just because they were too abstract, too general, and possibly too easy. In fact, there is a famous commentary by a very important mathematician in this period, Ziegel. Ziegel commented that, so he said, it is not by repeating om-om that we will be able to prove theorems. Because, in fact, in these theories, there is a notation om. It is a very important notation. But in fact, Ziegel was wrong. And category theory is always locally easy. But when you develop this theory, you begin to write dozens and hundreds of pages. Everything is locally easy, but it becomes deeper and deeper. And in fact, it has brought very deep changes, not in the whole of mathematics, but in some parts of mathematics. And it has also become important for some computer scientists. Okay, so these are the key notions which later on were brought together by Grothendieck to define the notion of topos. Okay, so then you see more than 12 years later, or maybe 14 years later, Grothendieck published a most important paper. Mathematicians call it the Tohoku paper because it was published in the Tohoku Mathematical Journal. And it was a new foundation for homology or cohomology, which Grothendieck developed. And in fact, the reason why this paper was published in this not very well-known Tohoku Mathematical Journal, it was that it had been rejected by more well-known journals. And in the decades following this paper, it has become so important that by now, everybody knows about the Tohoku Mathematical Journal because of this paper. So it was a genius idea from the editors to decide to publish this paper. Okay, and so Grothendieck defined a very general, very abstract framework for developing cohomology. In fact, he identified the formal reasons which allow to develop cohomology. So cohomology were linear invariants associated to topological spaces or geometric objects. Here I just mentioned that Grothendieck understood the general conditions for defining cohomology in terms of the theory of categories, okay, which had been introduced 15 years earlier by Eilenberg and Backlane. And so, in this framework, Grothendieck proved that you needed to deal with categories with some general features, so they have to be so-called Abelian categories, and verify some extra conditions which allow technically to develop cohomology. He identified these conditions. And in the same paper, he gave examples, and here he gave two series of examples. On the one hand, the categories of linear sheaves on topological spaces, whatever the topological space you are considering. And secondly, the categories of diagrams, so by now it would be called pre-sheaves, but the term used by Grothendieck was categories of diagrams, on small categories, so in particular, it contains the categories of linear representations of groups. Okay, so if you think about, you see, a topological space, and you can associate to that a category, the category of linear sheaves, on the one hand, and on the other hand, when you have a group, you can associate to it the category of linear representations of this group. And so Grothendieck realized that these two very different families of categories verify the same family of general axioms which allowed to develop cohomology. So here appears some strange phenomenon, which is the fact that topological spaces on the one hand and groups on the other hand have something in common. So this was, in fact, it is something amazing to realize this fact. Okay, and the next step in the work of Grothendieck was done by him immediately after the Tohoku paper. In fact, he identified the most general context which allows to define sheaves. And so this context was defined by him as a so-called site. A site consists in a category. A category is some kind of combinatorial structure, together with a general notion of topology. So here again, I don't want to explain anything technical. Maybe I can just say that the notion of category is a formalization of a notion, I would say, of a mathematical country. When you think about a country, you have cities, and you have itineraries relating the cities. Okay? You think of a map, for instance. And of course, when you have itineraries, something very natural to do is to compose in itineraries. You go from a city A to a city B through some itinerary, and then you go from B to C through another itinerary. And you can compose them. It defines an itinerary from A to C. So this defines some kind of mathematical structure which was called a category. So in fact, the word category is not very telling. Sometimes when I want to explain that more concretely, I say a mathematical country with cities, itineraries, and compositions, a rule for composing itineraries. And then a topology is some kind of notion of covering. Of course, the notion of covering is very natural for us. It is not even a mathematical notion because we are used to the fact that when we consider a complex object, Usually it consists in two pieces, and the pieces are glued together in a coherent way in order to form the complex object. So this, again, can be formalized in a mathematical way. It already existed in the context of topological spaces, but Grothendieck realized that it was possible to generalize the notion of covering to a much more general context, which is the context of categories, the context of mathematical countries. And he showed that this is a good context to define a notion of sheaf. Okay, so there is a well-defined notion of sheaf on any such context. And then he had another most simple idea, which was to consider not only linear sheaves, but set values sheaves. Sheaves without any algebraic structure, just sets. So in fact, most ideas of, or at least, yes, many ideas of Grothendieck are extremely simple. They are so simple that you wouldn't, most mathematicians would not have these ideas because they seem not elaborate enough. Okay? And this is one of them. Grothendieck calls that a childlike idea. And then he decided to give a name to the categories which are defined in this way, so mathematical countries, whose cities are sheaves on a given site. And all categories which can be constructed in this way were called toposes. This is the name topos. Okay, and then you may wonder, why did he choose that name? Why the name topos? Of course, topos is a Greek word. And what he meant is that the notion of topos is, for him, the most general mathematical notion to which intuitions of topological or geometric nature still apply. So for instance, what does it mean? For instance, the notion of point, the notion of subspace, the notion of open embedding, the notion of closed embedding, the notions of intersections, unions, the notion of localization. So you see, I am pronouncing here names of basic notions of topological or geometric nature. And in fact, Grothendieck said that the most general context where this notion still makes sense is the notion of topos. And in fact, it is not only something, it is not a free, it is not only an intuition of Grothendieck, in some sense, it is a theorem. It means that when you have a context with enough structures of geometric topological nature, you can draw a list of these structures you want, then this context has to be a topos. So there is a theorem which says exactly that. And he meant, because for this reason, that topology, of course the word topology was already in use, and for him, topology had to become the science of toposes. This is the real object of topology should become toposes. In fact, topological spaces in the usual sense give rise to toposes, but there are many more toposes. For instance, there is also a topos associated to any group. In fact, any topological space is a particular form of a site, and any group can also be considered as a site. Okay, so here you see this deep analogy of nature between topological spaces and groups gets a mathematical incarnation. So they are all brought together in the same mathematical definition, the notion of site, which gives rise to the same structure of geometric nature, which is a topos. Okay, so this is what I have written here, that any topological space gives rise to a topos of sheaves on this space, and the space can be recovered from this topos. And any continuous map gives rise to a so-called topos morphism. So morphism is a frightening word. Maybe a better word would be just an itinerary from a topos to another topos, because toposes also make up a category. There is a category of toposes, where the cities are toposes, and there are itineraries which allow to go from a topos to another topos. Okay, and it is possible to compose itineraries. And here, what we are saying is that any continuous map between two topological spaces gives rise to an associated itinerary between the associated toposes. So in this way, you can embed ordinary topology into the world of toposes, but the world of toposes is much bigger, much more general. And the notion of point generalizes to the notion to a notion of point of a topos. Any topos has points. Okay, so you see a basic geometric notion makes sense in the general context of toposes. Okay, and then there are the facts that classical notions of geometric spaces, such as algebraic varieties, manifolds, analytic or differential manifolds, give rise to associated toposes, usually endowed with an extra structure, which is a so-called ring object, so I don't want to say more about that. And classical notions of geometric maps, for instance, differential maps, analytic maps, gives rise to morphism of toposes, or if you prefer, itineraries relating the associated toposes, supplemented with an itinerary between the extra structures you have to add to this toposes in order to take care of the full geometric structure. But once again, in this way, you embed all classical geometric structures in a much more general type of mathematical structure. So, and you don't lose information, you just enter a new world which is much bigger than all classical worlds which become embedded into this brave new world. Okay, so a most important notion when you do topology or geometry is the notion of invariant. In fact, not only for geometry and topology. In fact, in mathematics, quite often, when you consider objects, you have to study more particularly invariance of the situation you are considering. And here, something very important is the fact that invariance of topological or geometric spaces, I mean classical invariance, which already existed before the discovery of toposes, usually can be defined in terms of their associated toposes, possibly supplemented with an extra structure. But once again, as the notion of topos is much more general, this means that this invariance by now can be defined in a much more general context than what I done before. So this allows to associate topologically inspired or geometrically inspired invariants, in fact, to most mathematical contexts. In fact, all this theory was created by Grothendieck firstly, in order to be able to define invariance such that cohomology or homotopy in context where homotopy or cohomology invariance had not been defined before. Okay? It just made this invariance much more applicable. And in fact, people working in algebraic geometry, especially in Padova, but not only, know that, especially in algebraic geometry, this has allowed to define completely new invariants and to prove incredibly many deep theorems. In fact, if you look at the story of algebraic geometry in the last 60 years, many very deep famous problems were solved. Many incredibly deep results were obtained, mainly thanks to these invariants, which are topos invariants, which could not be defined before. This is just because topos theory is wider than the classical theories in geometry or topology. So Grothendieck also insists that toposes have creative power. This is because when you try to define and to study invariants in terms of toposes, not only you make them applicable in new context, but it also leads you to develop the theory of these invariants in completely new directions. And ultimately, it makes them much more powerful. So this is, in particular, what has happened with cohomology invariants. So thanks to topos theory, Grothendieck was able to define etal and crystalline cohomology spaces, which proved incredibly useful. And also, by now, there are more in cohomology invariants defined more or less in the same way. But he also, Grothendieck also decided to understand some key features of cohomology theory in terms of toposes. And it led him to a much deeper understanding of even the classical results. So for instance, cohomological duality became, in the hands of Grothendieck, the so-called six operation formalism. So here I just mentioned that. So, in fact, what Grothendieck did is to give to the classical results a new formulation in terms of topos theory, but toposes are particular forms of category. So this means that everything had to be phrased in terms of categories, in terms of mathematical countries, with cities, itineraries, and composition of itineraries. And so, incredibly many deep results were obtained in this way. Okay, so by now, there is another side of topos theory, which begins with the two theorems I have written there. And in fact, these theorems are theorems about toposes, but most algebraic geometers who are used to work with topos theoretic invariants don't know these theorems. So I know that because I am mainly an algebraic geometer. And for many years, I had not even heard about these theorems, even though they are most important. And in fact, this is first because of these theorems that the connection with AI will arrive. Okay, so I could have written only one theorem, but I prefer to write it in two parts. And this is the relationship of toposes with language. So when I say language, I mean formalized language, because we are in the context of mathematics. And formalized language means logic. It means the syntactic formulation of mathematical theories. So here is the first theorem. So I begin with a site. So I already explained that a topos is defined as a category of sheaves on some site. So it begins with a site. But then when you have a site, you can associate to this site a theory in the sense of mathematical logic, in fact, a first order theory, so that for any topos, the itineraries from E to the associated to the topos associated to this site identifies with the category of models of the theory with values in this topos. So here it requires a few words of explanation. When you have a theory, logicians are used to talk about models. So usually they mean set theoretic models. So for instance, a model of the theory of groups is a set endowed with a structure of group. A model of the theory of topological spaces is a set endowed with a structure, with a topology, and so on. So a set theoretic model of a theory is a set, or possibly several sets, endowed with a type of structure written in the language of the theory. But it happens that any topos is as rich as the world of sets. Any topos can be considered as a mathematical world, which is just as rich as the world of sets. So this means that anything which can be done in the context of sets can also be done in the context of a given topos. So I just said that when you have a theory, you can consider its set theoretic models, but just because toposes are as good for doing mathematics, you can also consider models with values in a given topos. So for instance, I just said that a group usually is a set endowed with a structure of group, but you can also talk about models of the theory of group in the context of a given topos. It is an object of this topos given with a structure of group, and so on. And you can do that for any theory, and in particular for first-order theories. And then, the itineraries from an arbitrary topos to this topos can be interpreted as models of this theory with values in E. So this, what is this? It is, you start with a site, which is something of geometric nature, and from this site, you define the theory. So this means you go from geometry to language. You are talking about a geometric object, and what you are giving is to define from this geometric presentation a language which allows you to give a description of this geometric object. You go from geometry to language. You see, it is exactly as you look at something and you begin to write a description of this thing. This is the most important operation. And here, the second theorem tells you that you can also go in the other direction. You start with an arbitrary first-order theory, which has to be written in geometric form, so this is a technical detail. So this means, what is a theory? It is a language. It consists in a vocabulary together with grammar rules. Of course, in mathematical context, a grammar rules is what people usually call an axiom. Okay, so you have a vocabulary, a list of words, and a list of axioms. Okay, this defines a theory. And whatever the theory you start with, there is an associated topos. It is called the classifying topos of the theory, such that for any topos E, the models of the theory T with values in E correspond exactly to the itineraries from E to the classifying topos. So here you go in the other direction. You start with a language, a formalized language, which means a theory, and you associate with that a topos, which is a geometric object. So it is a mathematical analog of something very familiar for us human beings. When you read a text or when you talk with somebody, and this somebody gives you a description, tells you about something, You create an image of that. For instance, if it is a description, you can try to sketch a drawing of the description. You go from language to images. Okay? So these two theorems tell you that toposes provide a connection, a bridge, between geometry and language. And this is extremely important. I would even say it is essential. It is a miracle of mathematics because for us human beings, our ability to understand space and our ability to use language, our linguistic ability, are the two main abilities of our mind. And of course, they are related. The relation between these is most important for us, but this provides a mathematical model for that. Okay, so these two theorems have been known since the 1970s. So, in fact, when I heard about them, I was baffled that I immediately thought, but everybody should know this. Okay, so this this theory of classifying spaces, of classifying toposes, I just said, was introduced in the 1970s, but little developed, and in fact, most algebraic geometers which were used to work with topos cohomology, and also the notion of classifying scheme. In fact, I include myself into this world of algebraic geometers. In fact, most of them never heard about it. In fact, for several, for 20 years, after my student years, I never heard about it. And so this theory has been reborn, in my opinion, thanks to Olivia Caramello, an Italian mathematician, so in her PhD work in Cambridge, when she introduced and developed her theory of toposes as bridges. So here are the principles of this theory. So for her, a bridge is an equivalence between toposes associated with different theories or different sites. So I just told you that when you have a site, there is an associated topos. And when you have a theory, there is an associated theory. But you may wonder about the other direction. And here there is something very strange, which is the fact that completely different sites may give rise to the same topos. And completely different theories may give rise to the same topos. In fact, any topos can be presented by infinitely many different sites and infinitely many different theories. And so, her idea is that when you have different presentations, either geometric presentations or linguistic presentations for the same topos, this topos creates a bridge between these different presentations. So if you want, it is a mathematical theory of translations. Okay, we are used to that. That it is possible to express more or less the same things in different languages. And I also, just in the previous page, I told you about something which is translation between geometry and language. Okay, and then the second part of our theory and our technique consists in considering invariants of toposes in such a situation, and then to try to compute or express this invariance in terms of the different presentations of the topos by different theories or sites. Okay, and in this way, in fact, it is she has shown that in this way, in fact, it is a machine to create results. In some sense, you always get results. Of course, you have to choose your toposes, to choose your presentations, to choose your invariants, so that the results you get in this way are interesting for what you want to do. Okay, and this can be very subtle. But, So here is the principle of this theory, and it is really based on the fact that any topos can be presented in completely different ways. So you are trying to exploit this fact, okay? But once again, it is a mathematical incarnation of something very familiar to us, which is the fact that usually when you want to express something, there are many ways to express it, okay? So I will come back to that on that later. Okay, so then I want to come to AI. So here I have to say something a little personal. So how did that begin for me? I am a mathematician. I am not a computer scientist. I am not an engineer. So in fact, for me, it began completely by chance. So 6 years ago, when I was invited to give a talk at a workshop on applications of mathematics, organized by a company specialized in information technology. So in fact, I was very surprised to get this invitation because I am a pure mathematician. So I thought they are crazy to invite me. I wrote to them, thank you very much for this invitation. But I am sorry, I cannot tell anything interesting for you. I am a pure mathematician. Okay, so I rejected the invitation, and then insisting, I refused again, and then insisted again, so eventually I accepted. But I did not know what I could talk about, because once again, I thought that everything I knew could not be interesting for them. And as I had no idea, I decided to talk about what was interesting for me. Okay, so topos theory was interesting for me. And so I decided to talk about topos theory. But of course, I didn't want to be nasty with them. So I gave a talk, and my talk was not technical at all. In fact, as I thought that there was nothing at stake, I didn't even prepare the talk. I had no slides. I just arrived, and I talked for 1 hour. In very general terms, maybe I wrote a few words on the blackboard. I just mentioned very general ideas. So the first idea I mentioned, and I am sure I insisted on that, is what I just told you, that toposes provide a mathematical incarnation of the relationship between images and language. This had been very striking for me, and I thought, okay, they know images, they are human beings, so they know language, they are human beings, so it is interesting to mention that. And I also mentioned the fact that topos theory generalizes Galois theory. And to my huge surprise, it was enough to arouse the interest of some engineers working on IT. In particular, this one, so Jean-Claude Belfior, but in fact, it is not Belfior, it is Belfiore, because he is French, but from Italian origin. In fact, his native language is Italian. He's not a mathematician. He never studied mathematics. He's an information technology engineer. He was immediately interested in what I said. And in fact, in particular, because I had said that topos theory generalizes Galois theory. Because he had worked with Galois theory. Because he had worked on so-called lattice codes for mobile phone technology. And in fact, just for the needs of mobile phone technology, he needed to design lattices, in the mathematical sense of the term, with nice properties. And then he learned after some time, he was looking for lattices with nice properties, and he learned that for mathematicians, a good way to produce lattices with nice properties is number theory. So he began to study number theory. And then he learned that a good way to study number theory, a very powerful tool of number theory, is Galois theory. So he studied Galois theory, and in fact, he applied Galois theory. And in fact, you have to know that when you use your mobile phone, there is Galois theory inside. Okay, and, but of course, I didn't know. And, and so he knew, you see, he had experienced the power of Galois theory. And so he thought, but topos theory is more general than Galois theory, so it should be even more powerful. So he decided to study it. You see, he was an engineer, and I think he was 55 years old. And he began to study topos theory, okay? Without, he had never studied mathematics at university. So, and he discovered, while beginning to study topos theory, he discovered the work of two French mathematicians, so Pierre Baudot and Daniel Benka, which had interpreted a few years before Shannon entropy in terms of cohomology of some toposes. So you see, we find cohomology again. So this was a very nice interpretation, which could not have been made in terms of the classical theory of topological spaces. You really needed toposes to be able to do that. Okay, and he decided, Daniel Belka, to work with him, and he also convinced the Huawei management to hire Daniel Belka as a consultant. So they began to work together. And they began to develop theories, first of deep neural networks, and by now of semantic information, entirely in terms of topos theory. So by now, he has become, I would say, an expert of topos theory together with Daniel Benka. So this is how I discovered the world of engineers. And by now, I am very positive about this world. okay, and I became so positive that eventually I moved to the same company, in particular to work with these people, because it was so nice to exchange with them, to work with them, and to see how open-minded they are. I was baffled to see such an open-mindedness in the world of engineers, which before I didn't know at all. So less than 1 year ago, a young mathematician, Aurélien Sagnier, also joined us. And he's giving, in fact, he began last January to give an introductory lecture course on toposes. So this is mainly online, but anybody can follow this course. It is just enough to write a message to him in order to get the link to follow the lectures. The lectures are also recorded, so it is possible to listen, to listen to the recordings. And so you see, the lectures began 5 months ago. They should last at least 1 year. And after 5 months, there are still, according to what he told me, 700 people who are following this introductory course. So mainly engineers. Okay. and our team of engineers and mathematicians also follows the work of Olivia Caramello and her PhD students at the newly created Istituto Grothendieck. Okay. So this is 1 year old. It is a new foundation created in Italy by Olivia Caramello, as she is Italian. And one of the purposes of this institute is to develop topos theory and its applications in a systematic way. So in particular, this institute was just created 1 year ago, so it is a small institute, but it already supports PhD students. And in fact, this year, there is already two PhD students, very bright PhD students. Next year, there will be 3 more. And we really see topos theory as a continent, and there is room for many people working on this subject, both on the theoretical side and also on the application side. And we all have the idea that the two sides theory and application should be developed together. Okay, and I mentioned that, for example, this year, we run together an open seminar. When I say open, I mean open to anybody. Anybody can follow it, at least online, at the Lagrange Center in Paris. So, of course, Lagrange is Lagrangian, Lagrangian, so it is a French or Italian French mathematician, very important, and theoretical physicist. And, okay, so... okay, so by now, you may wonder, how is it possible that engineers working in IT and AI get interested in topology? So I told the story, but I need to tell, to say a few more words of explanation. Why are topologies interesting for engineers? So, of course, I already told you that I was very surprised that it could interest some engineers. But by now, you'll understand a little more why they became interested. So first, I discovered that engineers, in fact, prefer general theories with a wide spectrum of possible applications. Here, you see, in the academic world, I was used to people becoming very specialized. So you need specialization in order to try to solve deep questions, okay? And of course, it is good to do this, and you need to do it. But, in fact, I discovered that engineers, in fact, are, in general, they are less specialized. They are more interested in general methods which can be applied not only to one question, but to many questions, okay? So this, for instance, of course, they use PDEs, they use measure theories, so you see these are general theories. And topos theory is also some kind of very general theory. In fact, topos theory was discovered by Grothendieck in order to become able to approach most parts of mathematics with geometric-inspired or topology-inspired methods and intuitions. So Grothendieck had the idea that our most powerful mathematical intuitions are geometric intuitions, okay? And so you become much more powerful in what you are trying to do when you are able to approach a domain with geometric methods. And so topologies were created by Grothendieck for that purpose. Engineers, I discovered, also accept abstraction as long as the concrete is not lost. And here, I can say that topologies, of course, are very abstract, but they are related to the concrete through their presentations by sides of theories. So here, it is a most important aspect when you work with topologies. You see, there are topologies which are a mathematical incarnation of abstraction, but topologies are presented from sites or from theories which represent the concrete side of the story, the things you are really interested in. And so you have to play between these two levels, the level of the concrete and the level of the abstract. So this general scheme is very appealing to the engineers I am talking about. And here, there is another aspect which is why AI engineers, or some AI engineers, are very interested. It is the fact that they are looking for mathematical theories which can formalize basic elements of their practice and basic operations of the human intellect. And in fact, Grothendieck topologies are good candidates for the formalization of such basic elements and basic operations. So this is why I want to talk about in the last part of my talk. Okay, so the first aspect is the fact that on the one hand, topologies are very general, but on the other hand, they also allow to take care of diversity. okay? Because you see, the notion of topos is extremely general, and all basic geometric, topological notions, I already talked about the notion of points, the notion of subspace, all of these things, intersection, union, all of this makes sense on any topos. So you see, you can study topos theory in a very general way, in a way which applies to all toposes. But at the same time, there is an infinite diversity of toposes, and it is the story of toposes allows for the expression of diversity. So you have the two aspects. It is very general, but it applies to completely different contexts in such a way to take care of the most striking special features of this context. So, of course, for mathematicians, a most important aspect is the fact that key invariants of toposes can be defined for all toposes or for wide classes of toposes. In some sense, topos theory can also be considered as a general theory of invariants. Topos theory is the world of invariants. Okay, so here I have just said that it is possible to associate toposes to completely different parts of mathematics. So here you have topology, here you have algebraic notions, here there is a notion of space endowed with a measure. Okay, so this is yet another part of mathematics, measure theory or probability theory. So this also can be taken care of by topos theory. So this means it provides some kind of unification because all these very diverse types of objects can all give rise to toposes. But there is also a dynamic aspect in this unification, which is the fact that some theories or some sites have equivalent toposes, or they have toposes which are not necessarily equivalent, but which share general properties. For instance, there is a class of theories whose associated toposes are so-called pre-shift toposes. So this defines a very general type of theories which share general properties. So it provides a way to classify mathematical theories. So another duality which is very important is the duality of abstraction and concreteness. So I already mentioned that. So toposes incarnate abstraction, but the concrete level is represented by presenting sites or description theories. Okay, you have the concrete level and the abstract level, which are related to each other, and you can go in both directions. You say the operations of abstraction and going down to the concrete are two basic operations of our mind. In fact, we are very abstract-minded beings. I mean, we human beings. Okay? This is why we are able, for example, to use language. Okay? But then the expression, you see that here what is really wonderful is the fact that the operation of abstracting, of going to the abstract, is incarnated by the mathematical process, which consists in associating a topos to a site or to a theory. You see? But you can also go in the other direction, going down to the concrete. For instance, when you consider an invariant of a topos, for instance, cohomology, it is the most famous invariant, but there are many others, and you try to express it in concrete geometric terms. In fact, for instance, algebraic geometers do that a lot. They don't necessarily phrase what they do in these terms, but in fact, they are doing that. Considering abstract general invariants and then going down to the concrete. I am talking about the operation of extraction of an essence. You consider a given mathematical context, you associate to that a site And then you have the associative topos. So this is a two-step operation. Usually the most subtle step is the first one. Here you need to make choices. And this may be very subtle and delicate. And once you do this, so the Grothendieck idea is that combining these two operations is a way to extract an essence from a situation. You don't retain all the information, you only retain part of the information, but this information is the most essential part. If, of course, your choices are well done. And then, once you have the associated topos, which incarnate the essence of the situation, you can consider particular invariants which are related to questions you are interested in. Okay. Yeah, so I will end with this page. So this is most important. So here I give an extra information, which is the fact that usually when you start with a site, which is a category endowed with a topology, the associated topos is related to this category by a canonical functor, a canonical itinerary in the world of categories. And this functor allows you to consider this topos as a completion of the associated category. Okay? And this, once again, is a mathematical incarnation for a very important ability we have, which is the ability to extrapolate. Usually, when we are given an information, this information is always sketchy. Okay? For instance, I look at this room, okay, and I know that I don't see everything. For instance, there is this wall, and I know that behind this wall there is something. You see, but our mind always completes the information. What does it mean that we look at something and the image we have is meaningful for us? It is meaningful because we complete the image. We do that, of course, in an automatic way. And here, this process, which is a completely well-defined mathematical process, gives a mathematical incarnation of that. You see, so this is extremely important, the process of extrapolation. And in the other direction, when you are considering a topos and you choose to a particular presentation of it, this is the operation of sketching. You have an image. You cannot draw the full image, you sketch it, okay? And this also is most natural for us. For instance, suppose we have been a witness to something which happened, and we want to tell somebody what happened. We don't say everything we have witnessed. We give some partial information. This is sketching, okay? You can also think about a movie. You go to a movie, okay? You go to the pictures, and for 90 minutes, you watch a movie. In fact, this movie is very sketchy. It is only 90 minutes. But it is enough to give you a precise idea of a story of several figures which appear in this story. And you see, everything else is completed by our mind by extrapolation. And of course, the people who have made this movie, what did they do? They had an idea of a story they wanted to tell, and they decided to have a sketch. A movie is a sketch. And this sketch is extremely sketchy. Okay? So here, with the duality of sites and associated topologies, we have a mathematical model of that. Okay? So this is yet again a reason why AI engineers I am working with are extremely interested in topologies. You see, they provide a mathematical incarnation of some of the most basic, most important operations of the human intellect. I also mentioned this, once again, in fact, I will finish like that. I also mentioned, once again, because it is so important, the bridge between images and and language, which is provided by TOPOSIS. Okay? Here, and here I make an ending remark, which is the fact that when we are talking about images, we all understand what it is. All the time we are looking at images. But of course, for us, by now on mobile phones, we can take photographs. So we know that it is possible to capture images, and they consist in pixels. But what does it mean? So it means that for a mobile phone and then for a computer, images consist in points. Okay? It is points-based geometry. But this is very strange because for us, images do not consist in points. Okay? In fact, did you ever see a point? I have never seen a point. Okay? It is very strange to represent images as points. And here, a most important aspect of Topos theory is that TOPOSIS are geometric objects which are presented either associated to language, okay, which consists of description, or with sites. And I told you a site is a sketch. It does not consist in points. In fact, I told you the notion of points exists in the context of TOPOSIS. When you have a topos, you can consider its points. But the topos is not defined in terms of points. The notion of point is a derived notion. Okay? In order to present a topos, you don't need the notion of point. And this corresponds much more closely to what images are for our mind. So here you understand something very striking, very fascinating, which is the fact that in some sense, topos are extremely abstract. They are so abstract that many mathematicians are afraid by this level of abstraction. But in some other sense, they are also much closer to basic human intuition, experience, I would say pre-mathematical human experience, such as our experience of images. Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Questions? Okay, I leave the word to Alan.
Thank you very much for the conference. The first thing that I want to say is a curiosity. Grothendieck, before doing this famous Tohoku journal, the Tohoku article, did some article, actually, one article in Espace Vectoriel topologique.
Yeah, it was coming from functional analysis.
Yeah, from functional analysis. So my curiosity is the following. How, do you have an idea how he, why he switched from one to the other, and how his first experience as a functional analyst made some impact in the work after?
Yeah, so in this story, there is a part of just chance. Once again, in fact, so this is partly because of the French system at the time. So he needed to have a PhD, to get a PhD. And so this was so-called test d'état, so something very, there was a formal part. And when people defended test d'état, they had to present their work. Of course, so for him, it was his work about nuclear spaces or functional analysis. But they were also required to make a presentation of another subject, completely different subject. And so he chose to present the notion of sheaf. OK? So after that, you see, it is a very good idea. You have become a specialist of one subject, and you are required to make a presentation on a subject you don't know. So then you see what it produced. So, the, of course, another reason is just that Grothendieck was talking with other people, and he was introduced by, you see, so the theory of shifts was mainly French theory, so it was Leray, Cartan, Jean-Pierre Serre, and Jean-Pierre Serre became the main interlocutor of it was a mathematician Grothendieck spoke most with. And so Grothendieck was introduced to homological algebra, to deep problems in algebraic geometry, by Jean-Pierre Serre. So this was the human reason. So you see, so this also is very important when you are a mathematician or a computer scientist. You talk with other people, and you learn from other people. You see, here I have also talked in my own story about my meeting with engineers. It is good to meet people who don't work, who are very different from you. Okay. So after all, you see, we are in a university. In fact, the universities were invented in Italy. Okay. So, not here in Padova, but but Padova, okay, is a very old university, almost in Padova. So. But you see, in the world university, there is the idea that it should not be specialized. Okay? It has to be universal. Everything should be studied in a university. And the idea of a university is to have, of course, specialized people in many domains belonging to the same institution. And this institution exists in order for these people to talk with each other. So this is, you see, so we, maybe it is good for academic people to remember about that sometimes. What does it mean? I am in a university, what does it mean after all? okay, and then you have asked whether there is a relation between the previous work of Grothendieck in functional analysis and then what he did later. So you see, I said that so toposes are categories of sheaves, and the sheaves have to be defined on an underlying category, and done with a topology. And the topology is a formalized notion of covering. But then, when you look at the work of Grothendieck in functional analysis, he does something which at the time appeared very strange. Of course, he was working mainly, he was working with infinite dimensional vector spaces. And then he had the idea that an infinite dimensional vector space is just a union of finite dimensional vector spaces, okay? An inductive family of finite dimensional vector spaces. And so he had the idea that you could prove general properties on infinite dimensional vector spaces, first by studying finite dimensional vector spaces, and trying to identify properties which do not depend on the dimension. Okay? And in fact, he got some very deep results in this way, in particular in his last paper in functional analysis, which is devoted to metric spaces, metric properties of Banach spaces. He plays that game. Okay? And at the time, in fact, I think that most people thought, okay, this is too elementary. And in fact, this paper began to become influential maybe 20 years after it was published. And later, it has become very influential, this paper I am talking about. And this method of studying infinite dimensional vector spaces through the finite dimensional sub-vector spaces they contain has become a standard method in functional analysis well after this paper of Grothendieck. But then, the point I wanted to make is that, in fact, this can be interpreted as a covering, which means infinite-dimensional vector spaces make up a category. And in these categories, the cities, it is possible to define a topology such that any object is covered by finite-dimensional vector spaces. Of course, it does not make sense with the classical notion of topology. But it makes sense with the much more general notion of topology, which enters in the definition of a site. So you can see the unity of Grothendieck's thought. So this is really amazing. In some sense, he was already doing topology in a sense which became explicit years later. Really amazing.
I just mentioned that there is time of one or two quick questions. Then I hope that professor will join us for a refreshment at the ground floor. I'm sure there is another question by the director that maybe can ask separately if we want to leave.
Okay, so I cannot remember which term exactly you used a few slides before, but you said that when it is when there are equivalent topoi, then there are interesting bridges that are created either among the sites, I guess, or among the languages or or sites. Yeah. And do you have any striking example that we could understand of a bridge which is particularly relevant
In fact, the most obvious example which can be given, which is a most classical example which dates back to several centuries, of course, first you don't need topologists to talk about it, but it is already very remarkable and we are used to it. It is the equivalence between the algebraic theory of fields and the geometric theory of plane geometry, the geometry of straight lines in a plane, together with the Thales theorem, the Desargues theorem. So in fact, there is a complete equivalence between two theories, okay? And of course, this equivalence is given through so-called Descartes coordinates, okay? You see, in some sense, it is the most basic example, but it is already something really incredible. Because on the one side, we have algebra, okay, the theory of fields, and on the other side, we have plane geometry. And in fact, when we knew this, we can realize that, in fact, for Greek mathematicians, of course, they did not know Descartes coordinates, but they already had the idea of this equivalence. Because for what was a number for Greek mathematicians? A number was a relation between two geometric figures. And when you formalize that, eventually you can get a bridge. You see, already it is a deep bridge. In fact, it is the bridge you work with when you learn elementary geometry. You see, in high school or even before, you study coordinates. For instance, you discover that a line can be given by an equation, a first degree equation. You see, so this is the first example. A much more sophisticated example, which appeared much later in the 19th century, is Galois theory. Okay, so Galois theory, you see, on the one hand, so it has to do with algebraic equations. polynomial equations in one variable over a coefficient field. Okay, so you have the world of equations. Okay, you have the theory of equations. And then, on the other hand, you have a group, a symmetry group. Okay, and you have the world of actions of these groups. Okay, and in fact, actions of a group make up a topos. And then you can phrase Galois theory by saying that algebraic equations with coefficients in some field on the one hand, and some particular group on the other hand, the so-called Galois group, define the same topos. So you have two completely different presentations of the same topos. And here, when you have realized that, this is for that reason, that when I gave that talk for engineers 6 years ago, I told them that topos theory can be considered as a generalization of Galois theory. Okay, and of course, so Galois theory is already incredibly deep. Okay. In fact, it is, you see, these bridges are, it allows to make, it is extremely powerful, but you have to get used to, you see, already Galois theory, of course, has become very important in mathematics, it has transformed mathematics, but from the point of view of topos theory, it is extremely particular. And, okay, so we, in fact, other examples can be given, but here, you see, I have given to you two examples. So the first one, you all know it, and the second one, I'm sure that many people here know it. But
okay, thank you very much. As mentioned, we have time for a very quick question. I know that...
Thank you very much. I would like to ask you, you spoke about mathematicians and engineers. What about the computer scientists who also work in the area of AI? I ask this because I know that there are toposes which are not Grothendieck toposes, yeah, which are very important in computer science, which are elementary toposes, yeah, by Lovie and Tierney. So the question behind is what you think about the theory of elementary toposes and the possibility of generalizing shift theory to Lovier's to shifts, internal shifts, with respect to Lovier theory. In this way, also computable toposes, effect topos, can be considered toposes of shifts, but not in the original sense of Grothendieck, but in the more general sense. And this we could get the computer scientist into the picture.
No. So in fact, when I say the engineers, I mean in particular engineers working with computers. So I included computer scientists, but you see computer scientists with an orientation towards applications. So for example, you see, I have mentioned some people, for example, Jean-Claude Belfiore, Aurélien Sagnier, who is a mathematician, but in fact, they are already doing experiments, okay, with toposes. And the experiments are made with computers, okay? So this is, in some sense, it is engineer work because you try to realize something, okay? But it is also part of computer science. So when I said engineers, I meant in particular computer scientists. But of course, it is for instance a very important aspect of the. As far as I understand, of course, I am a mathematician. I am not an information technology guy, but I understand. I see just listening to people. For them, the most important question, the most fundamental question they have, is the question of semantic information. What does it mean, semantic information? Because classical information theory is a theory of information, including information without any meaning. Okay, the Shannon information does not distinguish at all between meaningful information and meaningless information. Okay, so at least the people I am talking about and working about, are for them the most important question is that one. Okay, and then by now, at least the people I talk with, in fact, think that semantics should be, in fact, that the mathematical objects which can incarnate semantics are Grothendieck toposes. Okay, you see, I have talked about this relationship. When you have a theory, you associate to it its classifying topos. And the classifying topos incarnates mathematically, as a geometric object, everything this theory, which means this language, can express. Okay, so you see, it incarnates everything which can be meant using this language. So it provides a mathematical incarnation of the relationship between language and what language can mean. In some sense, a topos is a library which consists in all the books, all the meaningful books, which can be written using the given language. Okay? So, okay, so, so elementary toposes, of course, so for me, it is one aspect of topos theory. So this is inner logic. So it is very interesting to study toposes in this way. But I, you see, a most fascinating aspect of topos theory, in fact, as I have illustrated, is the fact that it can be studied, and in fact, in my opinion, it has to be studied from different sides. Topos theory is like a mountain, a huge mountain, and you have completely different valleys leading to this mountain. And it is better not to forget any one of these valleys. For instance, the one I was used to was the geometric valley, but I explained there is also the linguistic valley. And what you are talking about is the inner logic valley. Okay, so it is also, of course, it has to be considered. It already allows to do a lot.
Okay, so thank you very much. I see that the discussion.